Hello, I'm Bruce Gladden, professor of kinesiology at Auburn University and president of the American College of Sports Medicine. I'm excited to welcome all of you to the 11th Hilliard Discussion, sponsored by the Huffines Institute at Texas A&M. I'm pleased to be a part of this effort by the Huffines Institute to bring science to the public, and I believe that these are the types of endeavors that the public should support and nourish. Using a debate format, the HD 11 is discussing a topic that we've all become more interested in over the past 18 months, specifically whether exercise and particularly vigorous exercise impairs immune function. As we've all faced an unprecedented infectious threat, many have looked for ways to boost immune function, or at the very least, prevent an impairment in immune function. We're certain that HD 11 will provide insight about this much debated topic, and we look forward to your participation in the polls and the discussion in this event. Again, we welcome you to this great event, and with that, I'll turn the program over to the director of the Huffines Institute, Dr. Tim Whitefoot. Tim, take it away.
Thank you all for joining us for Hilliard Discussion 11. I'm Dr. Tim Lightfoot, the director of the Huffines Institute, and like ACSM President Gladden said, we want to welcome you to the Hilliard Discussion sponsored by the Huffines Institute. The Hilliard Discussion is just a piece of the Huffines Institute's ongoing mission to encourage a dialogue between sports scientists, practitioners, and the public, and I hope that you enjoy it and learn a little bit as well. We're pleased that our topic for the HD 11 is vigorous exercise suppresses immune functioning. You know, we all may be tired and exhausted due to the pandemic, but we have to continue to figure out how to become as resilient as possible, in particular when we're talking about immune function. During the pandemic, exercise has constantly been touted as a way to strengthen our immune systems, and especially during the first few months of the pandemic, I saw more people outside walking and running than I'd seen in a long time. However, as with many things, too much exercise may not be a good thing. Our two speakers tonight are going to debate whether vigorous exercise suppresses immune function, and I'm really excited to hear their discussion. Now, while I'm anxious to get to our speakers, I did want to let you know about our general format tonight, so you'll know what to expect. The order of presentation was determined last week in a meeting with the speakers by a coin toss. Each speaker will have 15 minutes to make their opening statements, and then the speakers will each have 10 minutes to offer rebuttal and further comments regarding the other speaker's presentation. At that point, we'll have between 10 and 15 minutes where the speakers will answer questions from the audience. At that point, you'll be able to use the chat function on your screen to submit questions. Don't try the Q&A function. We're not using that tonight. And don't offer your questions early, because you won't be able to put them in until we turn the chat function on. After the question and answer period, each speaker will offer a 5-minute closing statement. I'll conclude the debate and you'll be able to participate in the post-debate poll. Then we'll close out the webinar. Now, before we get to our speakers, we want to get some sense of where the audience is at on this topic. So I'm going to launch a quick poll and ask everybody attending to weigh in. The poll is only going to be open for 30 seconds, so respond quickly. And that poll has launched. So at this point, as everyone can see on the screen, the yes, that they believe vigorous exercise suppresses immune function is slightly a little bit ahead of the no, and we certainly have I don't knows. We'll do a poll after the event as well, so we can see what the audience thinks at that time. And now without further ado, let's get to our speakers and get to the debate. Our first speaker today arguing the pro side of the debate is Dr. David Niemann. Dr. Neiman is a professor in the Department of Biology, College of Arts and Sciences at Appalachian State University, and director of the Human Performance Lab at the North Carolina Research Campus in Kannapolis, North Carolina. Dr. Neiman is a pioneer in the research area of exercise and nutrition immunology, and his current work is centered on investigating unique nutrition immunology, and his current work is centered on investigating unique nutritional products as countermeasures to exercise and obesity-induced immune dysfunction, inflammation, illness, and oxidative stress using a multi-omics approach. Dr. Neiman has received more than $11 million in research grants and published more than 380 peer-reviewed publications in journals and books. Dr. Neiman has served as the Vice President of the American College of Sports Medicine, President of the Southeast American College of Sports Medicine, and served two terms as President of the International Society of Exercise and Immunology. Dr. Neiman received the 100 Scholars Faculty Research Award from Appalachian State in 1997, the Montoy Scholar Award from the Southeastern American College of Sports Medicine in 2006, and the prestigious ACSM Citation Award in 2013. For fun, he's an acrobatic gymnast, or was an acrobatic gymnast, and coach for 10 years, and has run 58 marathons and ultra marathons. And so please join me in welcoming Dr. Neiman to the debate. Dr. Neiman, it's all yours.
Well, thank you, Tim, and thank you all for attending tonight. I started my first studies in this area about 40 years ago, and I'd like to share some insights that I've learned along the way. Really, the take-home message that I think fits here is that, in general, regular exercise supports and improves immune function, but a good thing can be carried too far. One of the best things I did early in my career was team up with a real powerhouse immunologist, Sandra Nielsen Canarella. In the early 1980s, she was well known for her work in transplant and stress immunology. In fact, here she is working with surgeon Leonard Bailey just after they worked together to transplant a baboon heart into this little girl who had a failing heart. Sandra was a firm believer that all types of stress had an effect on the immune system. So I went to her office and I said, would you be willing to start working with me looking at various types of exercise and what it does to the immune system? And we decided to start our earliest studies with marathon runners, and then we also shifted over to moderate exercise later on. Here is a graph of some of the major findings that Sandra and I published. We published many papers together. And basically, we put exercise workload onto this stress continuum. And when you look at immunosurveillance or the ability of the immune system to look for and destroy pathogens, a sedentary person has a somewhat normal immune system. But when you get into doing 30, 60 minutes of exercise on most days of the week, quite a few studies are showing that there can be an enhancement of immunosurveillance. However, this can flip. When you start getting into the red end of this continuum with heavy and overload exercise, and then illness risk kind of mirrors what's going on with the immune system. With moderate activity, there's a decrease, heavy and overload exertion, illness risk can go up. And sustained periods, and I want to make this very plain up front so that there's no confusion. Sustained periods of intense and prolonged exercise without adequate recovery can lead to overtraining. And that is also has been linked to illness going up. If you go to kind of the marginal area of this continuum and look at heavy exertion, this is more like marathon level exertion. And again, I want to make this very plain. This is high intensity, unrelenting, long duration exercise, like running a marathon or something beyond. Most studies in this area show a 2 to 6-fold increase in the odds of getting a respiratory infection. Now, there has been quite a bit of debate in this area. And what I am a little puzzled about is that many of the articles that have been used as counter arguments to all this have used exercise workloads that are well within this green zone. And this is 30, 60 minutes of all types of exercise, running, swimming, cycling, et cetera. In fact, we have shown that if the exercise is intermittent with a lot of rest intervals, like basketball or tennis drills, or even weightlifting, that you can put in hours of that activity. You can work out all afternoon. And as long as there is a back and forth activity going on, the immune system handles it very well. The real area of risk is high intensity that is unrelenting and long duration. And then the immune system reflects this physiological stress. So that led to Sandra and I putting together this J-curve model, where basically illness risk is about normal in a sedentary person, but it can go down about 40, 50% with moderate activity, but it can be elevated 2 to 6-fold with very heavy exertion that we just described. Now, I am very happy that the IOC put together a consensus group, and they went ahead and in their excellent paper supported this J-curve model. They did say, though, however, that this right side of the model may not apply to some elite athletes at the highest level who kind of have a survival effect. They may be genetically endowed to withstand those high levels of exercise. So Benta Peterson and Lori Hoffman Getz, they wrote two wonderful review papers as this area was progressing. And they put all of this into a subset of stress immunology. They felt that if you put everything together, that exercise immune interactions could be viewed as a subset of stress immunology. And they emphasized that many clinical physical stressors like surgery, trauma, burns, sepsis, induce a pattern of hormonal and immunological responses that have similarities to that of exercise. Sandra and I could not have written this better. We agree 100% with this. Once again, that the immune system reflects the magnitude of the physiological stress experienced by the exerciser. Now, I'm big on lines of evidence. This is used in many other scientific areas. This is where you look at different categories of research, like cell culture, animal studies, human case histories, epidemiology, and human trials. I feel that all of these converge to support this viewpoint that exercise stress can lead to immune dysfunction. We don't have time to cover all of this, but I want to start with some of the animal data, which I think is some of the strongest data we have. All sorts of animal models have been used, from rhesus monkeys to chickens to rabbits to horses. And basically in these animal models, they either will exercise the animal just before or just after they are infected. Like in this famous study, these rhesus monkeys were infected with poliovirus, and they found that severe exertion made the paralytic form more common. And this type of study over and over showed that exhaustive exercise predisposed the animal to really a longer and a worse infection. And some of these studies, a lot of these studies were actually done in the early 1900s. One of the best reviews on this was published in 1932. A colleague of mine that I've done many studies with, Dr. Mark Davis at South Carolina, he did many studies with mice. And in this particular study, he used the herpes simplex virus 1, and he had some mice, all of them were infected, and then some mice just rested. That's the green line. Some engaged in 30 minutes of moderate activity, and then the blue line, Some of the mice ran to exhaustion. It took them 2.5-3 hours. And noticed that their survival rates from this high dose of the herpes simplex virus was very low. And then in later studies, he went into the lungs of the mice and showed that the macrophages here pictured, that the macrophage activity was reduced, that the macrophages were less able to destroy viruses after exhaustive exercise. Now, if we go up another level of evidence to human case histories, I've had about 50 athletes through the years send me messages about how they had been very active in all sorts of athletic events, but then all of a sudden, they couldn't put out the exertion they used to. Their times were slowing down. Sometimes they had been sick, and then they had exercised when they were sick. And then they experienced months and some years, and some of these were friends of mine. They had lethargy. They just got tired real easy. They had muscle weakness. And let me just share one of the many letters that came my way over the years, just as an example of what some of these people experience. He said, I'm 50 years old, and I'm having a hard time feeling good on any run. My times are slow. Runs feel labored. Any intensity work causes me to get very fatigued. And eventually I get a cold. I've been a runner, albeit slow, since I was 13. Between 2002 and 2007, I got into adventure racing and did a good number, 24 in all conditions. Now, there have been several life events in the last 7 years that have been difficult, such as a divorce, attendant issues with my children, shakeups at work, and my dad eventually passing with Parkinson's. I can't pretend these had no effect on my physical resilience. Do you do any testing or diagnosis that may help identify the issue limiting me? I don't have time right now to get into the answer I gave him, but maybe we can talk about that in just a minute. Let me get to the next level of evidence, which are human epidemiological studies. These consistently show that when athletes go through prolonged and intense periods of training or race events, that they tend to get sick. One of the earliest studies was done by a friend of mine in South Africa, Edith Peters, and she looked at this ultra marathon and showed that during the 2-week period after running that race, a third of the runners got sick compared to 15% of live-in controls that were not runners. And notice the numbers. These were good numbers of people. Then over the years, there's Edith's study. Then we followed with our LA study, Greg Heath, another friend of mine with a runner study in South Carolina, a study in Germany. And you go down the line to even one that just came out last month from Finland. And here are all the data. We don't have time to get into the details, but they consistently show that athletes engaging in endurance events, either race events or high mileage training, that they tend to be at elevated risk of getting sick compared to some type of control group. So this led the IOC and the IAAF to start acute illness surveillance systems. They were worried enough by these data to start a surveillance system. And they went into what they called load management, and they worked with coaches and athletes to take better care of their internal and external loads to reduce their risk of illness. And then what they also did is, knowing that pathogens can get through a weakened immune system, they looked at various risk factors in addition to high stress. They put into their consensus paper that travel across time zones, mental stress, depression, anxiety, winter competitive events, lack of sleep, bad diet and low energy intake, and poor hygiene and vaccine avoidance, that all of these risk factors can add up together to allow pathogens to escape both arms of the immune system and make the athlete sick. When we get to the last level of evidence, the best human trial support that high exercise training stress is linked to immune dysfunction. And this, some of these measures persist for a few hours. I have done some recent work in proteomics showing that it can last for days. And what I've done here is I've put all of our data that we've collected during marathon races and then walking bouts on treadmills in the lab. Basically, if you look at various measures of adaptive and innate immunity, there are huge negative changes that occur compared to very modest perturbations with walking. Then inflammation is very high with these race events. Here, I've also ranked ordered IL-6 that we've measured in a variety of studies. Notice that walking, 2 hours of tennis, 2 hours of weightlifting, very modest changes in IL-6. But as you get up to some of these extreme events, notice the very, very high IL-6 levels. We noticed this at the Western States 100-mile race. We were there for 5 summers. And we measured cytokine changes in 154 runners. And notice how we showed that high inflammation, the levels are very similar to what has been shown for COVID-19. And this has also been shown recently, in 1902 at the Boston Marathon, where they showed high leukocytosis levels during that race. So in summary, I feel that regular exercise, weight management, healthy diet, stress control, sleep and recovery, these are the umbrella of protection that all of us have. And in general, these healthy habits help athletes get through what they're going through. But if they overtrain, if they don't get adequate rest and recovery, and a bad diet, pathogens can get through and make them sick. So thank you very much. And I just wanted to acknowledge my collaborators. Thank you.
Speaker today arguing the con side of the debate is Dr. Emily Lavoie. Dr. Lavoie is an assistant professor in exercise physiology at the University of Houston and one of the rising stars in our field. She has training and expertise in both immunology and exercise science. The overarching focus of her research program is to understand the effects of physical activity and exercise on the immune system. She is particularly interested and how exercise improves diseases and conditions associated with immune dysregulation, such as cancer and age-related declines in immunity. Her research also asks if infection history influences the relationship between exercise and immune health. Dr. Lavoie's funded active research program has resulted in many peer-reviewed publications and presentations to regional, national, and international science meetings. She has been funded by the National Institutes of Health, the American College of Sports Medicine, and is a co-investigator on a NASA grant. Dr. Lavoie enjoys long-distance running and cycling and credits growing up in Michigan doing cross-country skiing for her initial interest in exercise science. Dr. Lavoie, welcome to the debate.
Thank you. In tonight's debate, I will argue the position that vigorous exercise does not suppress immune function. I aim to convince you, the listeners, that we currently lack the evidence to definitively assign a single direction of an effect from an activity that has broad physiological impacts, namely vigorous exercise, to something as complex as the immune system. Indeed, while my opponent has provided examples suggesting suppressed immune function, I will share a few examples from the many in the literature demonstrating that vigorous exercise may be beneficial to immune functioning. The immune system is indeed a system. It is a network of various tissues, cells, and molecules that collectively aim to protect our body from external and internal threats, and includes protective barriers that aim to keep potential pathogens out, the innate immune system that provides rapid, nonspecific responses, and the adaptive immune system that provides targeted immune responses. These cells and tissues within this network interact with each other and with other tissues, and these interactions make it difficult to isolate the overarching impact of a single cell type or molecular signal. The immune system also has some redundancy, meaning that there's multiple avenues of protection. Many of the cells and molecules of the immune system are pleiotropic, that is, they have more than one action. And these actions may depend on the kinetics of the response, as well as the other cell types that are present. Therefore, let us keep in mind that observing a change within one single parameter may not necessarily lead to an obvious and predictable change in overall immune function. Considering whether a particular immune response is beneficial or harmful is also very context dependent. Anyone suffering from an autoimmune disease or even from seasonal allergies doesn't need to be told that an overactive immune system may be a bad thing. Inflammation begins with the detection of an insult, such as a pathogen, by innate immune cells, and these cells initiate an immune response by releasing inflammatory mediators and recruiting other leukocytes. Acute inflammation may last for hours or days, but importantly, it resolves after the insult is removed. Chronic inflammation may last for weeks to years. It can be caused by persistent infection or excessive or misguided inflammatory responses. Chronic inflammation is an underlying cause of some of the most impactful diseases in modern life, including cardiovascular disease and cancer. Therefore, while a pro-inflammatory response may be useful to clear infection, continued inflammation without resolution leads to tissue damage and disease. Thus, the ability of the immune system to return to homeostasis following an insult is important. The immune system has a variety of anti-inflammatory or pro-resolution mechanisms built in, including glucocorticoids such as cortisol. And it's important that we do not confuse these anti-inflammatory responses with immunosuppressive. Indeed, the actions of cortisol are also multifactorial and depend on the kinetics of the response. Cortisol released after exercise may return the immune system towards homeostasis and prevent tissue damage. Cortisol that is continually secreted in response to a chronic stressor, however, can end up creating a state of chronic inflammation. Viewed through this lens, the ability of the immune system to exhibit anti-inflammatory mechanisms following the pro-inflammatory phase that occurs during physical exercise may be evidence of a beneficial response that protects the body from disease. The pathology and the symptoms associated with an infection often arise from the immune response to that pathogen. In the lungs especially, the immune system must balance responding to pathogens in such a way as to rid the body of the infection, but without producing too much inflammation. Runaway inflammation in the lungs, caused by neutrophil infiltration and cytokine secretion, can result in respiratory failure, such as with acute respiratory distress syndrome. And importantly, there's evidence from animal models and experiments with human cells that exercise lessens the risk for this disease, and that this is mediated by exercise modulating the balance between pro and anti-inflammatory signals promoting survival. This illustrates again that we shouldn't equate anti-inflammatory immune responses with a lack or an improper immune response. The idea that the immune response depends on location is important to keep in mind when we consider results from exercise studies with humans. Most tissues of the human body are inaccessible or at least difficult to access in a standard research lab. Thus, most of the existing research is focused on results from the oral mucosa or from the peripheral blood, whereas very little is known about the immune response of cells in other tissues. These blind spots may be more than academic, as some of these other tissues are sites that may be more likely to encounter pathogens, such as the gut and the lungs. One observation that has been used as an example of suppressed immune response after vigorous exercise is that there is a decrease in the number of immune cells in the blood following exercise. However, the fate of these cells is not fully understood. That is, they may not be in the blood, but that does not mean that they're not functioning elsewhere in the body. And evidence from animal models indicates that these cells leaving the blood travel to the lungs and to the gut, as well as to the bone marrow, where they may provide stimuli for hematopoiesis. Thus, the fall in the number of blood immune cells that may be observed after a bout of vigorous exercise could indicate enhanced immune surveillance rather than suppressed immunity. Now that I've discussed several caveats that impact our interpretation of the effects of vigorous exercise on immunity, I'd like to share some results demonstrating the impact of vigorous exercise on health. I'm not asking you to ignore these first arguments, that is, that changes within a single parameter found in a single compartment within a single moment of time may not reflect overall immune function, but rather I'd like to point out that there is a chance that vigorous exercise may benefit immunity. Thus, if we allow arguments that decrements within certain immune parameters are present after vigorous exercise, as has been made by Dr. Niemann, we should also consider the results that indicate improvements in immune function. First, I'd like to highlight what is meant by vigorous exercise. The American College of Sports Medicine defines vigorous exercise as occurring between 64 and 90% of VO2 max, somewhat hard to very hard on the Borg scale. And again, the focus of tonight's debate is on vigorous exercise, not exhaustive. So vigorous exercise is associated with greater risk reduction for cardiovascular disease and all-cause mortality compared with moderate intensity exercise, as well as greater improvements in glucose utilization, greater improvements in VO2 max. Certainly, vigorous exercise is a regular component of an athlete's training regimen, even if they're employing polarized or pyramidal training intensity distributions. Given the importance of vigorous exercise for optimal mortality, metabolic, cardiovascular, and performance benefits, can we not expect benefit for immune function as well? And indeed, there's many examples of increased immune activity after vigorous exercise. So acutely vigorous exercise increases natural killer cell cytotoxicity against many different types of tumor cells. 60 minutes of cycling at maximal lactate steady state increases T cell expression of a variety of cytokines following stimulation. And completing a 75 kilometer cycling time trial increases monocyte and granulocyte activity. Vigorous exercise also appears to favorably alter the composition of peripheral blood, as exemplified by the increased ability to expand multifunctional T cells with cytotoxicity against tumor cells, as well as against viruses. Skeletal muscle is also a major source of cytokines, myokines, and will secrete immune-promoting cytokines, including interleukin-7 and interleukin-15 following vigorous exercise. The data I've shown on the prior slides suggests enhanced immunity after vigorous exercise in several different immune parameters for at least an hour after exercise. It may be that the transient effects of vigorous exercise have longer lasting benefit as well. Keeping in mind the idea that vigorous exercise training is positively related to VO2 max, epidemiological studies have linked VO2 max with improvements in many immune compartments. Men with a greater VO2 max exhibit a lower number of blood T cells expressing markers of senescence and are able to maintain a less differentiated, more flexible or naive T cell pool into older age. Along these lines, older endurance trained athletes have greater proportions of recent thymic immigrants and naive cells than do older sedentary adults, such that older master cyclists look more similar to healthy young adults in their lymphocyte characteristics than do healthy older adults. So these data suggest that training that results in higher VO2 max, like vigorous exercise training, may protect against age-related declines in immunity. Although we should be cautious in our interpretation of finding that exercise alters a single facet of the immune system, there are ways that we can examine immune function more broadly. One way is to measure responses to vaccination. Generating a robust and protective immune response to a vaccine requires the coordination of a variety of different compartments of the immune system, including antigen-presenting cells, T cells, and B cells. So an activated B cell will gain the ability to produce antibodies against vaccine components, and T cells remain important as they can provide a long-lasting cytotoxic cell-mediated response. Vaccine-specific antibody responses in many studies have not been found to be hindered by exercise performed immediately prior to vaccination. This lack of a suppression of antibody responses by exercise was demonstrated at multiple eccentric exercise intensities, as well as vaccination occurring immediately following the completion of a half Ironman triathlon. Elite athletes, such as those competing at an international and national level and training an average of 14 hours a week, actually exhibit more robust responses to the influenza vaccine, including both neutralizing antibodies and multifunctional antigen-specific T cells. More recently, an acute bout of cycling exercise up to 80% VO2 max was shown to robustly mobilize highly functional SARS-CoV-2 specific T cells into the blood compartment. This increase in antigen-specific T cells was directly proportional to exercise intensity, and these exercise-mobilized cells proliferated more vigorously when stimulated with peptides and maintained a broad diversity against SARS antigens. Further, neutralizing antibodies to SARS-CoV-2 were transiently elevated during exercise after both infection as well as after vaccination. Returning to tonight's question of whether vigorous exercise suppresses immune function, I ask you to remember that the complexity of the immune system makes it difficult to ascertain whether a behavior that has wide-ranging physiological impacts, such as vigorous exercise, is truly suppressive. Indeed, anti-inflammatory responses are not necessarily an indication of immunosuppression. And we need to bear in mind that many important sites of immune function are inaccessible for many exercise immunology studies. In fact, it may be that vigorous exercise, shown to be related to lower all-cause mortality, is also beneficial to immune function. And we can find evidence in the literature of increased immune activity after vigorous exercise within several different immune cell parameters, including innate cells and adaptive cells, as well as evidence for long-term improvements for immune function. And finally, when we consider measures of immune function that encompass coordinated immune responses, such as after vaccination, we do not see consistent signs of immunosuppression. Rather, vigorous exercise may improve vaccine responses. Thus, I hope you agree with me that we cannot say that vigorous exercise suppresses immune function. And this brings me to the end of my opening arguments.
Thank you, Dr. Lavoie, for that opening argument, for the opening statements. For the audience at this point, what we're going to do is we're going to turn the mics back over to the speakers for each a 10-minute rebuttal in response to what they've heard so far. We're going to go in the same order that we went in before. So Dr. Neiman, you're up.
Yeah, so thanks, Emily. I think, see, we're This is what happened in our debate article with the investigators from the UK, is I think we're talking on different parts of that exercise stress continuum. We are talking about the entire exercise workload that it gets to the high end. I actually agree, Emily, with everything you just said, that the data are very supportive that when you engage in vigorous intensity exercise of that 30, 60, 90 minute range, that there are many, many benefits for the immune system. I said that up front, I agree with you 110%. There is no argument there. To us, it's more what happens to the body when the exercise gets to a high stress level, because it is high intensity for a long, long time. Now, you mentioned that you can't really look at this using one parameter. And that's why recently we've been going into a human systems biology approach. And it's just been wonderful to go down this road. We're using now metabolomics and proteomics, genomics, lipidomics to better understand the stress to the immune system using this biology approach. If you look at metabolomics, exercise has a profound effect on the human metabolome. More than 300 metabolites will shift after a 75-kilometer cycling bout that takes about 2.5-3 hours. And these data are on 20 athletes that cycle for 75 kilometers at 68% VO2 max while consuming water only in an overnight fasted state. What happened was here they were pre-exercise when they came into the lab. And then they shifted into this stress zone that their metabolome shifted there. And then an hour and a half, and then 21 hours later, their metabolomes had not yet shifted back to their normal state, showing that the entire metabolome is shifted during exercise. And most of these are lipids, lipid metabolites. And we'll get back to that in just a second. We've also been doing a lot of proteomics. The beauty of proteomics is that from a single drop of blood, we can now measure 600 proteins. So we trained this athlete who became the first human to trek across Antarctica. He did that in about 54 days, 932 miles. And we taught him to take these finger prick samples. And he did that for a couple months before the trek while he was training. And then every week, it was every Thursday morning during the 2 months of the trek. The red line is his stress scale. We used a training distress score. It's a psychological scale. He was at very, very high stress. Anything over 20 is very high stress. He was at 40 during the last month of the trek. Mm-hmm. So using proteomics, what we found most of all is taking all of these proteins into account, that it was primarily his neutrophils had a huge decrement during the last month of the trek that continued during 4 or 5 weeks of recovery. So he had sustained neutrophil dysfunction and several aspects of neutrophil dysfunction. And this was captured by 25 different proteins related to innate immunity. This is the new direction for our field, is to use this systems biology approach so that we can look at the whole body's response to stressful levels of exercise. And I agree with you, Emily, you can't just use a single parameter anymore. We need to do this. Our latest area has been oxylipins. And oxylipins are these oxidized fatty acids. They have many vital roles, including regulation of inflammation and immune function. We have found that 75 kilometers of cycling to exhaustion has a profound effect in increasing levels of 64 different oxylipins. And so these oxylipins, many of them are pro-inflammatory, again, indicating huge stress. So I do agree, Emily, that our field needs to go towards more of a systems biology approach to better understand how exercise stress affects the immune system. I agree with you. I just want to make sure, though, that you understand, I agree with you all the way on everything you just presented, that vigorous intensity exercise that is of a moderate duration has wonderful effects on the immune system. Again, I'm talking when you're at that far end of the continuum. Thank you.
You have the stage.
Thank you. And I think we might be finding more areas of agreement tonight because, sure, I agree also with Dr. Neiman that if we get into the very, very extreme levels, exhausted exercise, that might indeed be decremental as well. I'm just focused on vigorous exercise for today's debate. Share screen. For this rebuttal section, I'd like to focus on some of the arguments that were made in the first portion of Dr. Neiman's talk, where he was looking at the effects of vigorous exercise competition, including marathons, and that the idea that it might increase upper respiratory tract infections or leads to latent viral reactivation, as these are arguments that have been made in support of this idea that vigorous exercise can suppress immune function. And I aim to convince you that these arguments are susceptible to confounders, which undermine our ability to definitively say that vigorous exercise is immunosuppressive. And indeed, there's many counterexamples in the published literature that do not demonstrate a link between vigorous exercise and infection. So one confounding variable when examining infection risk after competition is psychosocial stress. Many studies have linked mental stress to reduced immune functioning. And this is important to keep in mind when we consider athletic competition, as the desire for a particular result can induce psychological stress and anxiety. When we look in the psychology literature, adults with a chronic psychosocial stress or with higher levels of anxiety display impaired immune responses to vaccination. Even shorter term examination stress can impair vaccine responses and slow wound healing. Further, in an experiment where healthy adults were experimentally infected with a respiratory virus, the severity of the resulting infection increased in a dose-response relationship with the increased psychological stress of the participants. High levels of psychosocial stress also associate with reactivation of latent viruses, such as herpes simplex virus or varicella zoster virus. Stress is also a confounder in animal experiments, such as those that have been mentioned earlier, that have used forced treadmill running as the exercise stimulus. Is this in mice is much more stressful than voluntary wheel running. An additional common confounder relates to disrupted circadian rhythms or sleep. Many athletes must travel for their competition, and travel is often accompanied by disrupted schedules or circadian rhythms if time zones are crossed and disturbed sleep. Each of these factors has been associated with reduced immune functioning. Sleep deficiencies, such as shortened sleep or sleep of poor quality, is associated with increased risk of infection, as well as increased latent viral reactivation. Even a single night of sleep disruption is associated with differences in salivary markers of immunity. For example, waking salivary cortisol levels correlate with the time spent awake the prior night. Traveling and racing increases one's chance of coming in contact with a pathogen. And this hardly bears mentioning with our current pandemic experience, but an excellent way to avoid contracting an infectious illness is to avoid crowds, which is difficult to do in a mass start race or in team sports. Indeed, we can find other examples of increased infections during crowded events that do not involve exercise, such as religious gatherings. And the pandemic has taught us that choir practice may even be an infection risk due to exposure to others who may be harboring a virus. Further exposure risk may be heightened amongst Olympic athletes living in the Olympic Village or amongst military cadets living and training together. It's also important to distinguish between symptoms arising from an infection and symptoms that are resulting from another cause. Heavy breathing during vigorous exercise, especially if performed in cold, dry, polluted air or with allergens, may cause physical disruption to airway passages and result in respiratory symptoms that are similar to those that are caused by an infection. And I don't doubt that these symptoms in and of themselves are disruptive to training and to competition, but I do think it's important to distinguish the cause of these symptoms as they will indicate different treatments. Indeed, when attempting to identify causative agents for reported upper respiratory symptoms over a 5-month period, only 30% of the cases could be traced to a viral origin. In a separate study, antiviral treatments given to athletes suffering from upper respiratory symptoms and complaining of general fatigue failed to alleviate those symptoms. Reports of infectious illness episodes during major sporting events, including the Olympics, also highlight the non-infectious etiology in many athlete-reported symptoms. Predominant risk factors in this particular study were found to be mechanical and dehydration stresses generated within the airways and the level of airborne pollutants, irritants, allergens that were inhaled by the athletes under the high ventilatory conditions. The difficulty of isolating the effects of exercise from confounding variables, as well as the difficulty in determining symptoms versus an infection, help explain why there are several examples in the published literature reporting no difference in the incidence of episodes of upper respiratory symptoms between athletes and the general population. For example, elite swimmers from the Australian Institute of Sport exercising an average of 3 to 4 hours a day were surveyed over a 30-day period. The reports of an upper respiratory symptom episode did not differ from the active or the sedentary groups that were included in the study. And as suggested by this title, the study also examined salivary immunoglobulins like IgA and actually found higher values in the athletes relative to controls. Further, data examined over an 8-year period from elite cross-country skiers demonstrates an average of just 3 respiratory tract events per year with an average of 5 days of symptoms. This is no different from reports in the general population. This study further assessed factors associated with reporting symptoms and found that international air travel yielded the greatest odds ratio for reporting symptoms within the next few days. And so when they accounted for confounders in their models, training volume, training intensity were not significantly associated with reporting symptoms. Indeed, there's indications that high levels of physical activity may actually reduce the incidence of upper respiratory tract infections. A population-based cohort study of Swedish adults found that higher levels of physical activity were associated with reduced odds for upper respiratory tract infectious symptoms over a four-month period. Similar results have been published by my opponent in tonight's debate, where U.S. adults in the upper tertile of physical fitness reported reduced incidence of upper respiratory symptoms compared to the lowest tertile. And while exercise intensity was not included in this report, it seems likely that some portion of those in the highest fitness groups who were exercising five or more days per week engaged in some form of vigorous exercise. At the very least, then, these data do not support a link between vigorous exercise and increased incidence. And indeed, if we move on to those people who certainly do have very high levels of vigorous exercise, perhaps even exhaustive, that would be ultramarathoners, again, there's data to suggest a decrease in illness rates. This was a survey of more than 1,200 active ultramarathoners, and they concluded that the runners reported fewer days of missed work or school due to illness than the general population. Vigorous exercise has been suggested to compromise the body's ability to prevent the reactivation of latent viruses, such as Epstein-Barr virus. Evidence for this has been taken as the finding of increased viral DNA in saliva. However, it's also been reported that EBV, or Epstein-Barr virus, DNA can be found in healthy individuals and is not necessarily associated with symptoms, limiting the diagnostic value of viral shedding. An alternative approach is to characterize antibodies to EBV. A cross-sectional study comparing athletes and controls did not find a difference in EBV serology or in infection prevalence. Further, a longitudinal observation across the competition season of international level endurance athletes reported stable levels of EBV antibodies and that these did not differ from control subjects. Thus, the literature is not conclusive that vigorous exercise as practiced by elite athletes impairs viral control. So to conclude this portion, I hope you agree with me that there is not conclusive evidence that vigorous exercise suppresses immune function to lead to increased infection risk. Indeed, there's a variety of factors that need to be considered that will determine whether an individual may develop symptoms of infectious illness, including psychological stress and sleep. The likelihood of developing an infection is also dependent on encountering that pathogen. And so circumstances which increase pathogen exposure should be considered in these epidemiological studies with athletes if we're really trying to understand if exercise itself is driving infection risk. Further, not all symptoms of infection have an infectious etiology, but may rather be caused by physical irritation of the airways. And there's many examples in the literature demonstrating no difference or even reduced incidence of reporting infection-like symptoms amongst athletes or people with high levels of physical activity. Finally, diagnosing latent viral reactivation and linking that to symptoms has been difficult. Several studies, no differences were found between the elite athletes and the controls. Thank you.
I want to tell the audience that I have opened up the chat feature for questions. So go ahead and type in some questions there and we'll get those to the speakers. I want to start off with the first question though, it was some mention of genetic factors. Is it possible that elite athletes have a unique genetic profile that may predispose them to more an increased incidence of immunological problems? And let me throw that question to Dr. Lavoie first. Dr. Lavoie?
I think it's probably likely, yes, that athletes at the elite level do have different genes than the rest of us. But if this extends into their immune system to make them more susceptible to infection, I don't know that the data is there to suggest that athletes are at any greater risk for infection due to problems with their immune system. Perhaps, greater exposure risk is there, but not necessarily due to immune decrement.
Okay. Dr. Neiman, would you like to address that?
I'm actually writing a review paper right now on precision nutrition. And a lot of that is on nutrigenomics. And the problem is that field of using genetics to even predict athletic talent, there's no consensus. And so to even have any genetic data that would indicate whether a person's immune system could withstand heavy exertion better than somebody else's, we're not even close to that. I think eventually it may be found.
Great, thank you for that response. We have a question from Troy. Let me pull it back up here. How does longer duration, low intensity aerobic exercise, for example, a marathon run, which I'm not sure I would consider low intensity, but how does that compare to shorter duration, high intensity anaerobic exercise, such as like HIIT, high intensity interval training, when looking at influence on immune function? And Dr. Niemann, we'll let you go first on that.
Yeah, we have some HIIT data looking at the cytokine response. It's hardly anything. It's any time there is exercise intermixed with rest intervals, sports play, labor, HIIT training, we have always found that it appears that there is immune recovery going on during those rest intervals, and there is no inflammatory cytokines that accumulate or anything negative that we can see. Also, the entire energy expenditure typically is rather low, and I don't think the person has dug deep into the carbohydrate stores. You know, again, I think we're talking in different parts of the continuum. When you get way out there and you've been out for several hours of high intensity running, cycling, and basically have depleted your carbohydrate stores, that is, to us, one of the major factors that explains the high inflammation, oxidative stress, and immune changes that we see at that far end of the continuum where they get exhausted with glycogen depletion.
Right. Dr. Lavoie, what are you going to talk about? You want to say anything about HIIT as compared to what we normally think of as exercise, strenuous exercise?
Yeah, I think that's an excellent question. And it's great that Dr. Niemann has looked at this in humans. We examined it in my group in animals and mice. But again, then all the caveats about treadmill running in mice, perhaps being a stress in and of itself. I do know some data in humans, though, that perhaps suggested HIIT training amongst people with compromised immunity, breast cancer survivors, that perhaps the HIIT training some caution needed to be used in that particular case. So I certainly think it bears looking at more closely, particularly for people with known immune complications.
Great, thank you. Michael has sent us a question that says, both panelists alluded in different ways to the respiratory tract as the particular focus or not of exercise-induced respiratory infections. What are the thoughts about the possibility that vigorous strenuous exercise specifically impairs the local respiratory immune function? Emily?
Yeah, and I think sort of the focus that maybe both of us had on upper respiratory tract infections, where that's just traditionally where the field has been. So there's a lot more reports in that area than looking at other types of infection. As far as local immune protection for upper respiratory tract infections, in humans, really, we're limited to looking in the saliva and the oral mucosa. And so people have examined different types of immunoglobulins, which are found there. And that is a bit difficult to do. We can, again, have this back and forth where, you know, this person found that the immunoglobulins were decreased and these people over here found that they were increased. So there certainly seems to be a mix of responses, perhaps depending on how that was collected. And you know, what is going on deep into the lungs in humans, real hard to say.
Okay, Dr. Niemann?
Yeah, so I mentioned that Mark Davis, his team has published many studies looking at lung macrophages in mice. And after moderate activity, the antiviral activity of the lung macrophages is enhanced. And then when the mice run for 2.5-3 hours to complete exhaustion, he has found that the lung macrophage antiviral activity is suppressed. So he has many excellent papers. And then he looked at various countermeasures, nutritional countermeasures to that.
Okay, great. Thank you both. We have an interesting question here, and I apologize if I don't pronounce the name correctly. Dal 9, I believe, when there was a mention of exercise response in relation to a vaccination, the questioner was assuming that you meant traditional vaccines. Is there anything known about exercise intensity effect on the immune response after the COVID vaccines, the J&J or the Pfizer or the Moderna? Dr. Lavoie?
So I had one reference on my first slide to responses. It was just a case study, so certainly more needs to be gathered, but it was showing that exercise transiently increased the level of circulating SARS-specific antibodies following vaccination. And I'm not sure what the vaccine type was that individual had received.
Do you know what intensity exercise they tested in that study?
Yeah, it was a variety of intensities. It went up to 80% of VO2 max.
Okay. Dr. Neiman, would you like to respond? Have you seen anything about the COVID vaccinations?
Not COVID, but as you know, there's quite a few studies on exercise training and the antibody response to the flu shot. And several of those studies show that older people who train aerobically compared to randomized controls, that they end up with a better antibody response to the flu shot. So that we know, and I think it will end up that will be the same with the COVID-19 vaccines.
Okay. We have a question from, I think, the only person ever to watch all of our podcasts, Kevin. And Kevin brings up an interesting example of the marathon monks in Japan and how these three monks ran across the Sahara, and after all of them got sick after doing about 18 miles a day, but after they recovered, they walked or ran for more than twice that distance for the rest of that activity. And so he uses that as a basis for the question about, is there a chance that sustained vigorous activity can be and its effect on immunity can be a moving target for the top end? So as you train harder, you'll get sick, but then you get stronger as a result. Dr. Neiman, what would you think about that question?
You know, I presented some of these case histories of people who, you know, the guy that we brought up, I mean, he was an adventure athlete, had done 24 of those in the midst of a lot of kind of family issues. And he broke down. I mean, he just simply could not train. My counsel to him was he just had to strip stressors out of his life, including exercise stress, and just get it down to a moderate level. I doubt he listened to my advice, but there are some people that just simply break down when they push too hard. And if those three monks, you said they were, I need to read that. I hadn't seen that. If they got sick and then were able to keep going, they might have been the type of individual that could handle that and keep going. The guy that I mentioned that trekked across Antarctica, he also has the world record for making it to the top of the seven tallest mountains in record time. And then he's trying to do it on each continent. He has all of these things that he does, world records, and he just keeps going. When we measure his immune response, it shows that it's really being challenged, but somehow he gets through those immune challenges and can keep doing it. And that's why I think the IOC committee mentioned that there are these elite athletes that do appear to be able to keep going on and not break down. I think, though, that more are not able to do that, that do break down.
Dr. Lavoie, any thoughts on this idea that you may break, but then you'll recover and get stronger as a result?
Sure. So I'm not familiar with the specific example that was mentioned by the listener, but it sounded like there was some running and then an injury or illness, and then they walked. So, you know, perhaps that they had developed some training. And so relative to where they were at the beginning to where they were at towards the end, their fitness had increased. So perhaps the physiological impact of that run or the walk was lower as time went on.
So I want to thank everyone for their questions. We're not done yet with the questions. I just want to warn everyone that we're getting a whole bunch of them. And I want to say to the speakers that I've counted five of them at this point that have something to do with The intensity of weight training versus that of aerobic exercise. So let me ask one of those to get to that question. Lauren says, does any one area of exercise have a bigger effect on immune function than another? For example, does cardiovascular, vigorous cardiovascular exercise have a bigger effect on immune function than does weightlifting? Dr. Lavoie, would you like to take that one first?
Yeah, I don't know that weightlifting or resistance training has been studied as deeply as has cardiovascular exercise in terms of its effects on the immune system. But it does seem to me, to my reading literature, that cardiovascular exercise does have a larger impact on immunity. Dr. Newman.
Okay.
App State, I think, you know, we have a real hardcore faculty in the strength area. So I've done some studies with them. We did one where for 2 hours, we put some good weightlifters through, I think it was 12 different exercises, 3 sets with rest intervals. And by the end of the 2 hours, they were completely exhausted. They had really worked out hard for 2 hours. And yet all of the cytokine responses and the other immune responses, we published papers on this, were very modest. I mean, it looked like they'd just been out for an easy brisk walk or jog. And so again, it falls into what we have found. We did another study with 2 hours of tennis drills where they were just going back and forth, hitting the ball, doing this. There was a coach. And again, very easy immune response. We've seen this repeated. Like we've done it with rowing drills, back and forth. So if there is intermittent back and forth with rest intervals, and that's weightlifting, we and others have found that there just doesn't appear to be anything negative, even if it goes for a couple hours.
So strength training.
Well, it definitely is easier on the immune system, I think.
So Charles H. has, we have several Charles that are sending us questions. Charles H. has asked, what is known about changes in lipid metabolites associated with exhaustive exercise and markers of immune cell function in the same individual? Dr. Neiman?
Yeah, so this is an area that we just published some papers on. And so lipidomics is a sub-branch of metabolomics, and then a sub-branch of lipidomics is looking at oxylipins. Oxylipins, we've shown that at least 60 to 70 of them go way up during exercise, but it's transitory and they're all back down to normal within 3 to 5 hours post-exercise, even after 3 hours of exercise. These oxidized oxylipins, some have white hats, some have black hats. Some are doing good things, some are doing bad things, but many of them are pro-inflammatory. They're elevated in disease states, obese states, and post-exercise. And so we've been looking at how to countermeasure that. And we've shown that a couple of blueberries a day for 2 weeks will knock those down. We've shown that carbohydrate ingestion during exercise will knock those down. So these oxylipins are regulatory. They regulate both inflammation and the immune system. And that's why we're going towards the systems biology approach, because it allows us to look at how the whole system is responding. And oxylipins have emerged as a very important endpoint for both nutritional interventions and sports nutrition type studies.
Dr. Lavoie, would you like to address that, the effect of lipid metabolism at the same time with exhaustive exercise?
Yeah, I'm certainly going to defer to Dr. Neiman on this. It actually raises more questions to my mind. I don't know if I'm allowed to pose a question to the fellow panelist, but one thing that occurred to me is if these lipids are elevated in a disease state versus the elevations that we see with exercise, are those elevations more transient with exercise? And so are they really indicative of the same result as if they had been elevated for a longer period of time as with the disease?
Great, thank you. Stephanie asked, is there any evidence to suggest that there's an increase of circulating immature immune cells during or after exhaustive exercise? And she gives us context, in a septic patient, immature immune cells, such as banded neutrophils, indicate prolonged inflammation or infection and a decrease in the effectiveness of the immune system. So I guess she's asking about, are these things as a mark used as a marker, or have you seen this in during or after exhaustive exercise? Dr. Lavoie?
All types of immune cells do increase to some extent with exercise. It does seem to preferentially mobilize the cells which are more antigen experienced, so not the immature phenotype, but they will certainly increase in number as well. I don't know specifically for the band of neutrophils. I can't give you any hard numbers on that. But for other cell types generally, yes, they would increase with exercise.
Right. Thank you.
We've shown that banded neutrophils go up with exercise, heavy exertion. And then I believe, Emily, it was the group in Germany showed that immature B cells go up during exercise.
So Sue B has sent in a question. It's an interesting question, the one that I had as I was looking at the literature. And as she notes that as it was being presented about the vaccination in athletes, that it was normally done at the end of a marathon or a competition, or at least it appeared that way, when it might be predicted that would be when there's a suppressed response. Has that been the normal design for those types of studies where they give the vaccination after the competition, Dr. Lavoie?
So the particular article that I had shared on the screen, I was using to suggest that there is not a suppression that occurs following the triathlon in that particular instance, as the vaccine was given after the triathlon in this supposed immunosuppression window. I know in the cases of eccentric exercise, the vaccine is delivered following eccentric exercises. The idea that the eccentric exercise, that resistance training is going to mobilize immune cells to that area receiving the vaccine. And the thought is that, well, they'll be there, they'll be in that muscle, they'll be responding. So maybe they'll take up the vaccine and generate a stronger response to the vaccine in doing so. So with resistance exercise, I think there's a good reason behind giving the vaccine immediately following. But with the triathlon, I think that was more looking, trying to test this open window theory.
Okay, Dr. Neiman?
Yeah, so, you know, if you have an exhaustive exercise bout and then a vaccine is given either before or after, the antibodies take a week, 2-3 weeks to form. And I just don't think it's logical to assume that the antibody response is going to be governed by that one bout of exercise, because there's just too much time involved beyond that. I think a great study was done by Brunsgaard and Bente Petersen, where they did what's called the delayed type hypersensitivity response. We've done that before. And you just put prongs into the skin, and then the next day you look at the antigen response in the skin. And that was shown to be impaired 60% after heavy exertion. So I am more into something like that that is closer to the exhaustive event rather than an antibody response that is going to take a long time. And I just think there's too many other factors.
Our last question, and I want to thank everyone for sending these, have been great questions, and I'm sorry we haven't been able to get to all of them. But our last question comes from Richard, and I think it's a good, as we head into the concluding statements, it's something for us to think about, and I'd like your responses up front, and hopefully this is not stealing either one of your thunder. But Richard says that basically that the disagreement seems to be over the term vigorous. And I guess my question then, based on what Richard has noted here, is that perhaps we need to really talk more about volume, or is it better that we talk about intensity and duration? Dr. Lavoie?
Yeah, so when I'm thinking about tonight's debate and the statement that we're discussing is specific for vigorous exercise, so I thought it was quite useful to go to, well, what is the definition of vigorous exercise? What is this message that we are sending out into the public? And so if we instead want to talk about exercise of a particular intensity, exhaustive intensity, or a particular duration, then I think we need to be very specific that that's what we are saying. But when we're talking about vigorous exercise, let's talk about the vigorous exercise.
Dr. Neiman?
Yeah, so Sandra Nielsen Canarelli and I, we have operated under the stress concept since the beginning, that when the exercise workload gets to a stressful level, that's where it becomes a factor in immune dysfunction and illness. We've said that from the beginning. I don't like the word vigorous because that's just an intensity word. I think we really need to look at the entire exercise workload. And for any particular individual, there's a sweet spot where they can exercise and recover. Athletes often push it to the very limits, trying to tread that line very carefully so that they can recover and keep training. And so we have been operating more under that stress concept and look at the entire volume and workload. And I like what he said, it really is the combination of duration and intensity. And when it gets to a stressful level, that's where I think the immune system suffers. And again, all the studies Emily brought up, I agree that if everybody get out and do that type of exercise, everybody would have better immune function. I'm talking more about the elite athletes that are pushing the edge on the far end of the continuum.
So thank you to the audience for all your questions. Those were great questions. And hang with us. We have concluding statements, and then we've got our post poll that we'd like to see how people's thoughts are trending at that point. And so thank you both Dr. Lavoie and Dr. Neiman for your answers. We're going to conclude the debate with a 5-minute segment from each person with their conclusions. So Dr. Neiman, you're up first.
I kind of said my summary statement just now, talking about where we're talking about the stress end. But I just wanted to get into one area that keeps coming up all the time is that individuals, especially athletes, aren't capable of reporting their illness symptoms. This particular validated instrument was developed very carefully by Bruce Barrett, who is a physician at the University of Wisconsin. He invited me to his department up there. I gave a lecture and then we had a lot of time together. He carefully showed that individuals are capable of reporting symptoms that agree with the physician-based diagnosis. Frankly, it gets me going just a little bit when people keep acting like athletes can't tell when they're sick. I've run 58 marathons. I've rubbed shoulders with many other athletes. And I'm telling you, they know when they're sick. And then the other issue here is there is no gold standard for assessing respiratory illness. People think that if you use RT-PCR, that's the gold method, but it really isn't. It has issues. Often pathogens in 20 to 40% of people with illness symptoms cannot be detected with these kinds of so-called gold standard techniques. So there is no great way of assessing the pathogen that a person may be infected with. And of course, we've learned from COVID that there a lot of people can be asymptomatic. And so it's a murky area. And so we've relied on these questionnaires where people report their symptoms. And Bruce Barrett, just a very careful investigator, he has shown that people do a good job. And I really wanted to bring that up because it does bother me a bit. And then, you know, the IOC, what a wonderful list they put together. This is my last statement here. Emily brought up that there are many factors that work together to make an athlete perhaps sick. And we agree. Again, it's all under this kind of stress umbrella. IOC is saying that these athletes need to be very careful about their sleep and nutrition, hydration, their stress, that they need to keep their training under control. They need to be monitored. They shouldn't exercise when they're sick. They should minimize pathogen exposure. They should isolate infected athletes. and everybody should be vaccinated. So this is a wonderful list that I think indicates that the IOC and others realize that it's a collection of factors that can bring the athlete down. And that's what Sandra Nilsson Canarelli and I have always operated under. It's a multifactorial issue.
Dr. Lavoie?
So in tonight's debate, I argue the position that vigorous exercise does not suppress immune function. And I hope I've convinced you that the complexity of the immune system makes it very difficult to assign a single direction of an effect on immune function. And so changes within a single immune marker may not reflect the immune system more broadly. And I know this is a point that Dr. Niemann agrees with me on. We do need to keep in mind as well, though, that anti-inflammatory responses are as critical to immune function as our pro-inflammatory responses. And so reports of increased anti-inflammatory pathways after exercise are not necessarily indicative of a maladaptive immune response, but rather may suggest a return to homeostasis. Much of exercise immunology is also limited by the inaccessibility of many tissues that the immune response is carried out in. Thus, a change in immune activity observed in the blood or the oral mucosa after exercise may miss immune activity, which is occurring in other tissues. And this limitation extends to the metabolomics data as well. It's limited to when is the time point that we are looking at, what are the tissues that we are looking in. So the other side of the debate has point to instances of decreased immune function. There's, of course, these published counterexamples of enhanced immune function and measuring responses to vaccines. So I think that this is a really important measure for immune function because vaccine response demonstrates a clinically relevant alteration in immune function. So generating a response to a vaccine requires a coordinated response across multiple aspects of the immune system. And so I think it's a really good proxy for understanding responses to a pathogen. And importantly, immune responses to vaccination have not been shown to be impaired following vigorous exercise, or even if we want to look at elite athletes and high levels of training, just more generally, we actually see increases in the response to vaccines. Reports of infectious illness following vigorous exercise, we should also carefully consider the context that these are occurring in. So with all of the potential confounders, psychological stress, disturbed sleep, all of these features that Dr. Niemann calls under his stress umbrella, and I think we're in agreement here as well, that there's a multitude of factors, some of which may be enhanced with athletes. They may have this greater chance of exposure to pathogens or increased disruptions in their sleep. However, I think it's really important that we separate that out from the effect of exercise in and of itself, because it's going to change how we interpret what we should do to help keep the athletes safe. So is it that they need to exercise less, or is it that they need to practice better sleep hygiene or reduce other sources of stress in their life as much as they can? And again, we have some examples, even with the athletes practicing very extreme levels of sport, like ultra marathoners, actually showing reduced infectious episodes. And so one final thought I'd like to end on, and it relates to this idea of vigorous exercise and what really is vigorous exercise. So I think it's important because we need to be careful in our messaging of the potential risks for vigorous exercise. So this has been a source of disagreement in tonight's debate, but if we think about the messaging that we're going to give, and if people start to hear that, oh, vigorous exercise is risky, they might then also wonder, like we have been wondering, well, what is the definition of vigorous exercise? And so a reputable source that they might hit upon is ACSM's definition as shown here. So if this is what people are going to hear, vigorous exercise is risky. Here's vigorous exercise. Is this really the message we want to send? Especially thinking of the known benefits versus these murkier risks for this level of exercise. So we know there's all these positive effects of vigorous exercise. It's associations with optimal metabolic cardiovascular performance benefit, strong relationship with risk reduction for all-cause mortality. So I hope you'll agree that in the light of these well-established benefits and absent strong conclusive evidence of immunosuppression, that we should send a message that no, vigorous exercise does not suppress immune function. So I thank you for your attention tonight and also certainly extend my gratitude to Dr. Lightfoot for organizing tonight's debate.
Thank you, Dr. Lavoie. And I'm going to ask the audience, hang with us. We've got a big announcement coming up. And plus, we've got that post-show poll. We'd like to see how what you think now about our question. But I first want to, we at the Huffines Institute really want to thank both Dr. Neiman and Dr. Lavoie for agreeing to take part in this debate. It's not often that scientists are asked to debate in a live format or in public. We often do it in the literature, in the scientific literature. And so it takes a special individual to put themselves up front for a discussion like that. And so while I know that they can't hear your applause right now, which we'd be normally doing right now, I know that you're all applauding and giving them a standing ovation. So thank you, Dr. Lavoie and Dr. Neiman, again. I also want to thank all of you in attendance today for being here with us. Without you all, we wouldn't have these types of events. One of the things that I want to share with everyone, and there'll be some more details in the closing credits, is that the HD 12, which is the next debate in this series, is going to be on February the 2nd, 2022, and will feature the debate topic, the keto diet is not the best diet for athletes. We have two great speakers for that, and so it'll be an interesting, great discussion. And so please stay tuned, as I said, for our closing credits, and you'll see more information on that. I want to recognize the Huffines staff and all of the individuals that helped us hold the event. You'll see their pictures in a few minutes in the closing credits. Just know that while I'm on screen, we've had a bunch of folks working behind the screens to make this thing go okay, or go great, actually. These are the same folks that will be putting the video of tonight's debate on our website within the next 48 hours or so. So check out our website to see the video replay and push it out to your colleagues and friends, because this really has been a great debate. So now we're going to take a few moments and we're going to do another 30-second poll. So and when this comes up, please go ahead and mark it if I can get to the next poll here. There we go. And here we go. Just a few more seconds. Okay. And you should all be able to see the results on your screen. I'll remind you at the beginning, it was 52% yes, 35% no, and 13% don't know. And so congratulations to our debaters. I want to thank you all again for coming. We all hope that you stay safe, stay active, and please stay healthy. And we'll see you in February at the Hilliard Discussion 12. We'll be right back.
Thank you.